How's it going, everyone? My name is Jazen Sounds. Welcome to the first episode of my Learning Sound Design series. In this video, we are going to be going over topics like frequency and polarity, as well as exploring different ways of looking at audio. While we might not actually be using any synthesizers in this episode, I highly recommend you watch to the end, as this might actually be the most important video in the entire series. Just a quick reminder that all these videos are being released completely for free right here on YouTube. And if you'd like to support the channel, please consider joining the Patreon or becoming a YouTube member. Also, feel free to check out some of the presets on my website or make a one-time donation with PayPal. All links are in the description. Thanks so much for your support. I said earlier that this is the most important video in this series, and I really do mean that. This is information I didn't learn until many years after getting started with sound design, and my skills definitely suffered from it. These are the rules of the game, so to speak, and being able to understand and manipulate them will do wonders for your ability to work with synthesizers and sound. While some of it may seem unnecessary and complicated in the short term, I really do believe in learning this information as soon as possible if you plan on getting into sound design. So, what actually causes us to hear sound? The short answer is that sound is created by vibrations traveling through the air, and when these vibrations reach our ears, our brain interprets them as sound. In the context of digital audio, speakers or headphones are engineered in such a way to be able to recreate these vibrations on demand. Let's take a listen to a quick example. What we are looking at here is called the waveform view, and waveform is really just another word for the vibration that our speakers are being told to create. Not all speakers are created equal, however, and some of them follow these instructions much better than others. That's why quality headphones or monitors are important when working with sound. Having bad monitoring is like trying to paint a picture in the dark. You might think you are doing a good job, but in reality, it could look much different than you imagine. The reason that this waveform is so complex is because it represents an entire song, full of different sounds across the audio spectrum. The position of the waveform at any given time tells the speaker what it should be doing. These peaks along the top tell the speaker cone it should push to its outwardmost position, and these peaks along the bottom tell the speaker it should retract to its inwardmost position. It's this pushing and retracting of the speaker that creates the vibrations in the air that we interpret as sound. Since a speaker is considered bipolar, this means that these bottom peaks don't actually represent zero, and are capable of creating just as much sound as these peaks on the top. Instead, zero is represented by this line down the middle where the speaker is being told to pass through its resting state. What causes a speaker to generate sound isn't the position that it's currently in, but rather movement between these top and bottom positions. When a speaker is generating as much sound as possible, it is moving from its outwardmost position to its inwardmost position, or its inwardmost position to its outwardmost position. Watch what happens when I boost the level or gain of this audio clip. Both the upper and lower peaks move away from the zero line, which results in the increase of amplitude. Have you ever wondered what the reverse polarity switch does? You might have seen it before in plugins represented as the Greek letter phi. What it's doing is taking the upper peaks and swapping them with the lower peaks. Listen to how this affects the audio. It actually doesn't affect the audio at all, since the speaker is still being given the same instructions, but just from a different direction. Reversing polarity can actually be useful when done alongside other audio clips playing simultaneously, but that is the topic for a much later video. Let's test how well you've been paying attention. Just by looking at it, can you tell what kind of sound this waveform is going to make? Despite the fact that the speaker cone is told to be in an outward position, hence the fact that it is above the zero line, it doesn't make any noise once it gets there due to the fact that no movement is occurring. Remember, amplitude is created by movement. Specifically, the difference between the peaks at the top and bottom of the waveform. Also, did you notice the click at the start and end of the demo I just played? This is because the speaker is going from its default position at the zero line to suddenly being close to the top of its range. It's this quick movement of the speaker which causes the click. You might have run into this issue before when slicing up audio clips in your DAW. To fix this issue, make sure your audio clips start and finish at what's called a zero crossing point, which is exactly what it sounds like, somewhere where the waveform crosses the zero line. This way, when you play back the audio, the speaker won't have to instantly jump up or down from its default position. You may have noticed these red and blue lines earlier. Since we are listening in a stereo environment, these lines actually represent two different audio signals, one for the left channel and one for the right. Some DAWs might display this by default, and it will look something like this. Don't worry about this too much right now. Again, this is a topic for a later video, but just be aware that these channels don't necessarily have to play the exact same thing. Now let's talk about loudness. We know that the movement of the speakers creates loudness, but how is loudness measured, and what would happen if we tell our DAW to play something really, really loud? Firstly, loudness is measured in a unit called decibels, and our DAW is capable of playing anything from negative infinity decibels, which is as quiet as possible, to zero decibels, which is as loud as possible. This type of loudness meter is pretty standard across all DAWs, and this one is actually made of two meters, one for the left and one for the right channel. Now let's take this audio and push it way past this zero decibel point. It may look at first that our DAW is playing something louder than zero decibels, but what is actually happening here is a form of distortion called clipping. Here I've rendered out some clipped audio, and we can see that it actually isn't able to pass the zero decibel mark. What is happening here is as the waveform extends out of the amplitude range, the top and bottom of our waveform are being literally chopped off, hence the name clipping. We are getting these drastic movements of our speaker, resulting in extreme loudness, followed by these short, intermittent silences where our speaker pauses for a second at the top and bottom of the waveform. Clipping can be a cool effect when used intentionally, and if your audio is slightly clipping while you are working on a track, this is no big deal as it is hardly noticeable. However, if you leave it that way, just remember that it is something you'll have to deal with later if you want to avoid this type of distortion. There is no greater sign of an amateur producer than exporting a mixdown that is obviously clipping. Now take a look at these two waveforms. When I play it back, what will be different about them? We know they are the same loudness since the difference between their peaks is the same, but it is obvious just by looking at them that they aren't going to make the same sound. Let's take a listen. If you said that these two waveforms are playing at different frequencies, you are correct. Frequency refers to how far the waveform travels before it repeats itself. Each time the waveform repeats itself, it's called a cycle. Frequency is measured in units called hertz, which represents the number of cycles per second. Something to note here is that amplitude has no impact on frequency. You can see that if I increase the amplitude, the frequency stays the same. You may have also noticed that this waveform looks and sounds a lot simpler than the one I was playing earlier. This wave shape is known as a sine wave, and it is the most basic waveform possible and the building block of all sound. In fact, every complex waveform, including the track we were listening to earlier, can be broken down into sine waves. But more on this in a moment. Take a look at this waveform. Can you guess what it's going to do just by looking at it? If you said it will play a high frequency at a high amplitude, then transition to a low frequency at a low amplitude, you are exactly right. You may have noticed that frequency is easy to see when working with a single sine wave like this one here. But when we switch to something more complex, it's pretty much impossible to tell what's going on just by looking at it. This is because a track like this is made of dozens of sounds, which can be broken down into thousands of sine waves, all simultaneously playing at different frequencies and amplitudes. You can see here that this gets really complicated really quickly. If we want to understand the frequency content of something like this, the solution is to use some software that is able to look at this complex waveform and break it down into all of its simple waveforms so we are better able to see what is going on. This kind of software is actually referred to as a spectrum analyzer, and for our purposes, we will be using one called Span. This plugin is completely free and can be loaded up into any effect insert slot in your DAW, but I usually end up putting it on my master output. When we first open Span, it may look pretty overwhelming, but there are actually only a few controls here that we are ever going to use. First, I'd recommend dragging here on the bottom right corner to resize Span to better fit our screen. If we take a look at the x-axis, these readings represent frequencies in the audible range. The human ear is able to hear from about 20 Hz to 20,000 Hz, so Span has been optimized to show this. Here on the y-axis, we get our amplitude reading in decibels. If I move my mouse around, we get a readout on the side which shows the frequency and amplitude that my mouse is currently pointing at. Also, since we have no access to show time in spectrum view, we are only ever able to see one brief moment of our audio at a time. This means that the spectrum must update in real time and will only work when we are actively playing our signal. This may seem like a drawback compared to waveform view, where we are able to see the past and future of our audio signal even when nothing is playing. However, spectrum view makes up for this in the sheer amount of information that it is able to convey to us about our audio signal at any given moment. The only other control I ever really use within span is going up to this menu here and switching it into high res mode. I recommend using high res mode just about all the time, as it allows you to see what's happening with just a little bit more clarity. Remember this audio clip from earlier? Let's see what happens when we play it through span. We can see here that our signal starts at 440 Hz at a loud amplitude, then transitions down to around 300 Hz at a much quieter amplitude. Also, I should mention that frequency is musically referred to as pitch. Over to the right here, span will tell us the pitch of the current frequency value that our mouse is pointing at. Sine waves within span are represented as skinny little peaks like this, and since the signal I just played consists of only one sine wave, we only see one peak. Spectrum analyzers like span really shine when looking at much more complex waveforms, so let's play that track from earlier into span. Remember how I said that any complex waveform or audio signal can be broken down into sine waves? Well, this is what we are seeing. All these peaks here are the sine waves that can be used to represent this track. You may have noticed that this area over here doesn't seem to contain any peaks, despite there still being an amplitude reading. That is because this area is mostly made of noise, and since noise is the most complex waveform type out there, the amount of sine waves it takes to show it are just too many to be able to see them clearly with this resolution. An important distinction that I want to make. While all sound can be broken into its component sine waves, that doesn't necessarily mean that all sound is made by just sticking a bunch of sine waves together. A good analogy I heard for this is that a loaf of bread can be broken down into crumbs, but that doesn't mean that the only way to make bread is by individually compiling thousands of little crumbs. Okay, I think that's enough for the first episode. While watching and reading information can be great for learning, the best way to retain knowledge is to actually put it into practice. That's why at the end of each video, I'm going to be including a homework section of things you should do before moving on to the next topic in order to get the most out of it. The homework for this video is to install and get comfortable reading span. I've included a download link in the description. There is a menu up here where you can select the color of the frequency readout and also remember to put it into high res. Try loading up some of your favorite tracks, samples, or presets to see how the response changes with each one. Compare using spectrum analysis and span to the default waveform view of your DAW. Can you notice any similarities between the two? Can you ever tell what span might show just by looking at the waveform view? Thanks so much for watching, everyone. If you'd like to get access to the patch I'm playing right now, as well as all the presets from all the previous videos, consider joining the Patreon or becoming a YouTube member. In the next video, you will be building on these concepts and talk about things like the harmonic series and be taking a look at oscillators, the core of subtractive synthesis, and the starting point for creating your own sounds. See you then.